Me too.
Self-publishing podcast episode number 80.
Welcome to the self-publishing podcast, where if you want something done right, you gotta do it yourself. And now, here are your hosts, the three whitest guys at podcasting, Johnny, John, and Dave.
Hey everyone, and welcome to the self-publishing podcast, the podcast that's all about how to get your words out into the world without contending with agents, publishers, or the other gatekeepers in traditional publishing. I'm Johnny B. Truant, and my co-hosts are Sean Platt and David Wright, here for the scintillating 80th episode of the self-publishing podcast. Yeah. Do you think we're going to catch up with Joanna? I was listening to her show today, and she's on like 180. But I don't know if she does every week.
If she doesn't do one every week, then yeah, probably. I mean, really, who would have thought we would have lasted past 10? This is kind of amazing.
A travesty.
And we got into double digits. That's pretty hardcore. I don't know that we deserve 3 digits. But here's to
it. We got to double digits. You mean 10?
Yeah.
Wow.
Well, so is Better Off Undead. So.
Well, Better Off Undead, yeah, but we're not pretending that's good.
I've been writing about all of this stuff, and it's like, it's meta. So I'm very aware of everything that I'm doing day to day, and everything that we're doing in the podcast, because I'm writing the Write, Publish, Repeat book, and so I'm writing about the podcast, and using the podcast for publicity, and funnels, and I'm just mired in, like, insane amounts of detail. Dave's gone already.
Somebody asked me just a couple days ago about starting a podcast, and they had all kinds of questions about starting a podcast, and I strongly advised against them starting a podcast. Like, you can do it, but I think that for most people, unless you're very clear on what you're doing, there's not really a return there. It's a lot of time. It's, you know what, it's like blogging in that way. It could be great for you, but you really have to know what you're doing and why you're doing it, and not just do it because, you know, someone told you to get out there and, you know, get your voice there. Because if you don't have a purpose, then it really can easily become wasted time.
Yeah, I mean, this is
like Better Off Undead.
Well, that's what I was gonna say, is that Better Off Undead is easy, like, it's the damage that it does to us is, except for Dave, is minimal. because we're already going. And it's just like, okay, let's go another half hour, 40 minutes or something.
Right, but would any of us do Better Off Undead if it wasn't piggybacked off of this podcast?
No, and we certainly wouldn't start it. Like, if we were going,
right.
Like, if we were going with Better Off Undead, then we might say, oh, okay, well, maybe we'll continue it. That's one level of would we do it. But the other is, pretend we have no podcasts. Would we start that sort of a podcast? And the answer for me, I think, is no.
Yeah, definitely not. And I think, I mean, we've talked a bunch of times about just not doing Better Off Undead and doing a longer self-publishing podcast. And there's value there, because here, you know, we get to learn and we get to grow and we get to you know, learn and grow with an audience who is kind of, you know, we all have different versions of the same goals. We're all, if you're listening to this show, you're most likely trying to write and publish. And so we're kind of all rowing our oars in the same direction. That's not necessarily true with something like Better Off Undead, where really we're just bullshitting, you know, and either people are there to listen to it or not, but it doesn't necessarily, it's not necessarily the best congruent use of our time. But it's fun. We do that for fun.
What?
or humiliation. You're
having fun?
It's our fun.
Yeah, if it wasn't fun, then there'd be zero reason to do it, because, you know, it is a time suck. But Johnny's totally right. It's easy. We piggyback off of what we're already doing.
It's... Yeah, and I did mention it. I mean, just in the interest of completeness, Write, Publish, Repeat, it's the aforenamed SPP blog book, it's in there, podcasting. Not in a ton of detail, but it's like, you know what this book, writing this book is like? It's very interesting, and it'll be interesting to see when you read it, because you have to read it, Sean. I don't know if Dave will read it. He can add it to his bucket list.
He won't read it.
And it's really, really long too, Dave.
Wait, real quick. Dave, have you sent out those questions yet?
Today. I will today.
Oh, for the interview?
I will today. Okay, yeah, so this is spectacular. So this book has been written in the time that it's taken Dave to send out the questions.
I'm a busy man!
It's
And you guys, this book is a behemoth, too. You guys are going to
like
love
somebody
it.
It's like somebody asked us, tell me about self-publishing. Like, imagine you're at a party, somebody says, tell me about self-publishing.
Well, that would be one hell of a party.
Right.
I would leave in a moment.
I've been at this party before.
And I've talked to those douchebags.
It's nested. So, like, I mean, the first part of just figuring this out was like, okay, so we have parts, we have chapters, we have sub-chapters, and then I'm like, I need, like, several more layers of granularity, because you keep realizing, like, okay, so tell me about marketing, okay? And then you say, well, let's talk about funnels. Okay, so let me start telling you about funnels, which is a subset of marketing. And then you get into funnels and you're like, okay, well, we need to talk about calls to action. And then you realize there's about four different ways that we use calls to action. And they're like, well, so the calls to action for the mailing list have to go somewhere. So you have to talk about how to set up a mailing list. And of course, you don't want to have a mailing list on a shared sort of a service. Otherwise, you're digital sharecropping on somebody else's land.
Yeah, we have less jargon in the beam. Right?
It's not jargon. I mean, we explain it. It's very accessible, but it is a behemoth. I mean, it may top 100,000 words. It's a big bit.
I can't imagine it not topping 100,000 words once the questions are in there.
Yeah. Yeah, for sure. I mean, I had intended it to be 80, and it's the project that keeps on giving, because I'm just like, oh, hell, I got, like, right now, I'm in the middle of the marketing chapter, which is the biggest one, and I'm like, oh, well, I still have to finish up the email marketing section and how you can use your email list and why, and then, you know, how to grow your email list, and then the whole thing about reviews, which is a topic in and of itself, and then, like, advertising, you know, understanding ways to market, selling benefits, not features. On and on, and then I still have two more major sections to go. So,
but we've had a few meetings on Write, Publish, Repeat. You know, since before it was called Write, Publish, Repeat, and we keep thinking. You know, the project keeps ballooning. I mean, originally it was 50,000, then it was 60,000, then we settled on 80. Okay, this is going to be a good 80,000 word book, and now it looks like it'll be 100, maybe more by the time we get our interviews in, and that's a lot of words, but every time we kind of come back to it, we're like, well, if that's how big it needs to be, that's how big it needs to be. And we really want this to be the word. You know, we've talked before that we don't want it to be tactic-based at all. This book should hold up a couple years from now, no matter what. And we need to talk about that new KDP thing. But, you know, there's always this shifting stuff. Kobo's doing this. Amazon's doing this. And none of that should ultimately matter to the core things that we're trying to say in this book.
And it's comprehensive is the word. It is a comprehensive book. Like, I can't imagine anybody. I mean, obviously there's things that we don't know and all that stuff. But as far as what we know, like, this is the compendium. It's kind of ridiculous. So.
Yeah, we don't go into super detail about stuff like print. So we'll talk a little bit about print, but we don't get into, like, we don't get lost in the weeds. And I think that's the line that we're trying to cross or navigate, is that we want to cover as much as we possibly can without getting lost anywhere along the way. Am I echoing?
Am I echoing you guys?
Well, now you were.
No.
Not now. Go ahead.
Well, that's it. I'm done.
What's the subject of today's show?
Theme, but we have to waffle for a while.
Yeah. All right. Do you guys want to talk about that new Amazon thing that we got the emails on yesterday?
Yeah, sure.
Dave, hear that? I actually hit play. I've been listening to the what the hell? Now I have. Oh my God! The YouTube app is going and going. I don't even know what to do here. Look at this bullshit. What is with this app? I don't know how to turn it off.
Oh, I don't see anything.
oh, what the hell? So I tried the I just had the YouTube app open, and because I've been listening to I've been listening to those four new Eminem songs like on repeat.
Oh my god!
Through this so entire good. Thing, so I'm like obsessed with that.
Which is your favorite of the four?
Rap God.
Yeah, it's insane.
So, I would have come around with you on the playing that bit despite the copyright infringement. I think Eminem would be okay.
I think he'd be okay. It's just so good. It's just a minute.
All right, I'm going to play it. All right,
awesome.
All right, let me see if I can get this.
Takedown notice in 3, 2, 1.
You mean to tell me that they would have a problem with somebody saying, this is an awesome thing?
Well, no, what it is, YouTube's robots, basically, kind of like Amazon's robots, they search for stuff that's copyrighted within the videos, and if they sense it, boom, they just take it down, and then you got to fight to get it back up. Kind of like My Wedding Night.
I think it's worth it.
I do, too. Go. start at 420, so there's like that, so it just doesn't start.
420, huh?
Totally a coincidence.
I'm sure.
You're muted, Johnny.
Can you hear it?
A feeling.
Yeah.
Like something.
Okay, so you want me to skip ahead?
Yeah.
This is relevant to self-publishing.
You punch slap just in case, because even you
punch slap. I'm trying to do this on the fly.
I get away with it now that I ain't right, going from the future just to come and shoot you.
Here comes the fact
that it's made Ray J mad. His cat said he would like a fag and they were his cats singing to a man while he played Ray J. Man, that was a 24/7 special on the cable channel. So Ray J went straight to the radio station the very next day. Hey, Fab, I'm gonna kill you. Lyrics coming at you with supersonic speed. Summer, lama, duma, lama, you assuming I'm a human. What I gotta do to get it through to you? I'm superhuman, innovative, and I made a rubber so that anything you say is sticking off of me and it'll be you and devastating. More than ever demonstrating how to give a motherfucking audience a feeling like it's levitating, never fading. And I know the haters are forever waiting for the day that they can say I fell off to be celebrating. Cause I know the way to get it motivated. I make elevating music. You make elevator music. Oh, he's too mainstream. Well, that's what they do when they get jealous, they confuse it. It's not hip hop, it's pop. Cause I found a hell of a way to fuse it.
All right, I'll stop it there.
God, that is so good. It's so good. The wordplay in that song is just insane. It's so good.
So good.
I love that moment in the song where he's like, there's a John's echoing. Yeah, this is the worst.
Sorry, it's because I have to turn you guys up. But never mind, go ahead. It should be good now.
So that moment where he's got the guy who's like, and he just keeps going right over him. I know it's him, but
oh, I should have let it play. I'm not gonna do it again. But yeah, I know what you're talking about. He's like, I don't know how to write songs like that or whatever.
Yeah, it's just it's so clever, and I've been listening to that song like crack. It's good stuff.
I had a section in because I was writing. I'm trying to remember what it was that I was writing today that I actually mentioned. I'm not going to be able to find it on the fly, but I was writing something about I write to music, and I said something about the influence of what I'm writing. Well, whatever. But yeah. So that's been in my head constantly, and it's pretty awesome. So anyway, so topic. Right.
So, yeah. Before we get to the topic, let's talk about that. The Amazon. What's it called? The countdown.
The Kindle countdown deal.
Yeah. So, the.
I'm gonna make this YouTube app go away. It's just like the worst. Like I should have just played regular YouTube. Like I can't see you guys now. I just have the big old YouTube screen.
We just see Johnny B. Dave, do you wanna kind of give a little rundown on what it is?
Basically, it's a new feature for people that are enrolled in KDP Select. It allows you to discount your book choosing any time between 1 hour and 7 days. It must be at least $1 off the regular price. And during that time, even if you're below $2.99, you'll get the 70% royalty rate.
Jeez, that's a little bit... I wish that I'd known that about that like 2 weeks ago.
Well, don't get too excited. You are featured on a Kindle countdown page, and I looked at it right now. And right now they have, you know, they have authors that you know of for the most part. So my big thing on this is you still have to be KDP Select exclusive.
Oh, okay.
And you're competing with 400,000 books at the moment anyway that are in KDP Select to get on that page. There's a damn good chance you won't get on that page.
Yeah.
Well, what I was thinking, if it hadn't been KB Select, is I didn't need the publicity. I mean, I would have taken it, but it was more about I was discounting my book to 99 cents anyway. Wouldn't it have been nice to make it twice as much money? I could have made another, you know.
Well, it works. I could see a couple of contexts in this working. Again, it comes down to the things that we always talk about, like royalty, or sorry, not royalty, but inventory, right? Like the more inventory you have, the more you can experiment. So in Inkwell's case specifically, we could do this with Forevermore, because Forevermore is on it's on all platforms, but it doesn't really move, you know, on Kobo. So what's the difference? Like
we sold one copy on Kobo.
Yeah, so we take it off Kobo and we make it part of this thing on Amazon and try to make, you know, get traction there, make sure the calls to action lead to our other titles and leverage it that way. And that is a way that we could use it. But I think that, you know, KDP Select is a dangerous waters to get into. You are committing. Now, there was something I didn't understand. So, Dave, maybe you can explain this a little bit to me. On Twitter yesterday, Trish was talking about she was using a year as the metric. Why a year instead of 90 days? Do you know?
I'm not sure. Basically, I think she was just talking about combining it with BookBub, because from what she said, BookBub now makes you wait 6 months between books that you're promoting.
Oh, so okay.
If you were pairing it with BookBub, you'd have to wait, you know, more time after that. So
I'm distracted by our because our audience really, really hated the playing of Eminem.
Well, that just shows that they're good friends.
They're kind of bitchy about it. Like, it isn't even like we wish you hadn't played that. They're kind of like, well, I won't say more. But it's just like, dude, guys, just maybe hang in there with us a little bit. Like, that would be cool.
Open your minds, man.
What does it say? What does it say? I want to hear.
Get off my porch!
Most of it's probably ball busting.
I think my dad's watching. You call that music?
Look, any writer, anyone who is writing for a living or wants to write for a living, It should marvel at what that man can do with language. It is, he's very curious. Dave froze. Okay, I think he was gonna say, "Go read my copy blogger post on Eminem," which read it. It says exactly why I like that guy. He's a total thorough asshole. There's no question about it. But
I'm not even arguing for Eminem. I'm just sort of like, come on, guys, really? That's the feedback we got to get right away? Like 15 comments about how we're being just whatever.
Oh, anyway, I want to see these comments now. Where do I get them?
It's a pain in the ass because Hangouts added you have to like go to the YouTube video, which is really, really hard to find, copy the source, and paste it in.
Oh, that's bullshit.
Don't worry about it. It's just, okay. Yeah, don't worry about it. Kobo did the same basic thing with they have a countdown thing now too. Did you get that email?
I did get that email, and I thought that was awesome. But it's, you know, it's in typical Kobo fashion, it's very simple, right? And I mean that in a good way. It's like, okay, you go in, you set it here, you know, reset it here, and it's not like you have to be exclusive to them. It's just something that you get to do. Okay, so I'll bitch about Amazon for just a second here. So we've got that whole Unicorn Western thing going on, right? And
you need to explain that because nobody knows that.
Okay.
I was actually toying with not mentioning it because I don't want to get a whole bunch of sales at that price. But whatever, it's out the bag now.
Yeah, but I don't care. If somebody wants to like buy it for that, that's great, awesome. But basically, because of the way that Unicorn Full Saga was initially put up onto Amazon, it's being cross-referenced incorrectly. So through a bunch of shenanigans that I don't even know how to begin explaining, it's price matching against its own price matching self or something. And so ultimately the Full Saga is being discounted to just under $4 right now. And I think this is an interesting note, actually, Johnny. I like talking about this because we are selling more at $4 than we did at $10, but we're not selling enough to justify the lower price. So we're still made more money at $10 movement versus what it is now. And I think that's a pretty interesting thing because we've had these price discussions and we've never been able to compare it against ourselves because we've never been willing to knock it down to $4 to see what happens. And now this kind of happened and we're just dealing with it, but it's kind of funny that, you know, $10 is still a better price for that product. But anyway, trying to solve the problem is just, it's ridiculous. Like, it's been going on for 2 weeks. There's been many emails exchanged about it, and it, like, moves forward an inch at a time, and, like, now it's on two different pages, and it's, like, it's everything with Amazon just seems so complicated. Like, it's complicated to get help, and then once you get the help, it's complicated. And things with Kobo just seem a little bit simpler than that. They're definitely customer service friendly in that way.
Yeah, I don't know what we should do with that. Here comes Dave. Dave?
Google's hating Dave.
Hello, Dave.
Motherfucking internet's hating me.
So, okay, do we want to get to our topic then?
The ISP called and said, if you play Eminem again, we're cutting you off.
I thought that was our commenters. So anyway, to wrap up this Amazon new deal, I think we should experiment around with it a little. I think it's interesting. I do think there's a tiny bit of me that believes that Amazon's kind of desperate to get indies back because, you know, what was working for indies with KDP Select simply isn't working now. So there's not a lot of reasons for the higher quality indies to stick around in Select. And so I think that Amazon is smart to try to think of new ways to entice us. I don't know that this is it, but I think it'd be cool to experiment.
I think it's a good idea. I think it just depends on what other books you're using. Amazon sent out
exclusivity.
Amazon sent out another press release or whatever. Carl sent me an email. You can monitor your performance in real time. A new KDP report displays sales and royalties at each price discount side by side with pre-promotion performance, so you can compare results.
I like that. That's very cool, actually.
Yeah. And Carl's saying it looks like that everybody will be featured on the countdown deal page, but you'll just be on, you know, a different page number depending how you're ranking.
Right, but we know how that works. That's like for SEO, for search engine optimization. If you're not on page one, you know, there's very little difference between page 2 in search engine optimization and page 200. It just doesn't matter.
If they do a breakdown, if they have a breakdown, like where people can like look for, you know, specific genres, you might be ranking high in your genre, and that could help. So
that's true. That's true. I mean, look, here's the thing. At least Amazon is trying. At least they're looking for ways to kind of entice or bait indies back, and I think that's a good thing. It certainly isn't bad. You just kind of don't just do something because it's new and shiny. You know, really evaluate whether it works with your long-term goals and what you're doing. And you know, in our case, we actually have a perfect property that we could test it out with, so we should. But if you don't have that inventory, just be careful about, you know, only putting yourself out there because you're committing 90 days, and we know it takes a while to make a footprint in any kind of e-tailer. So by stopping and starting and stopping and starting, you're I think diminishing your ability to grow in those other places. Dave's reading Twitter or something.
No, I'm reading our comments page.
Oh. I want to see that.
Pam Stuckey says, this is my first time watching instead of listening. I keep getting distracted watching y'all and forget to listen. Yeah, we are rather stunning looking, aren't we?
Just you, Dave.
Yeah. Hedgehog or Porcupine? Ari's listening or watching. So, do we have a voicemail from her?
No, I haven't gotten to voicemails yet.
What the fuck? It's been 3 weeks.
Yeah.
3 weeks!
Okay,
if I called into this show, I would have a complaint. I'm calling in a complaint.
Let's do that and then get to our topic because
Let's do that. I don't have a voicemail. So.
Oh, we don't have any voicemails?
Voicemail. No, we have them. I just haven't done them yet.
Oh, okay.
I've been writing 5 billion fucking words a day. So I haven't gotten to voicemails. So the topic we're going to talk about today is we're due for a writing sort of a topic. Like, we've been talking a lot about marketing and stuff. So I thought we'd talk about theme and meaning, which is kind of a sticky topic, because I think if you set out deliberately to do that, it's kind of a recipe for disaster. So I don't know. Anyone want to take the lead on that?
No, this artiste? Is your subject. I'm the last guy that would be talking about theme.
No, okay. I think the point is that there's two ways to kind of say what you mean in a story, right? And that's to kind of approach the story from word one with, this is what I want to say, and I'm going to figure out ways to say it. Where the other half of that is, what does the story want to say? And we always talk about this in terms of character, right? Like, sometimes the characters just do things with your story that you don't anticipate. They take it in places that we don't expect, and we kind of have to listen to that. But that's more of a micro level with your characters. But on a macro level, your whole entire story can take you to places that you're not quite expecting. So we could take the beam as an example, and there's a lot. Actually, let's do Genesis as an example, because we've wrapped our Genesis. Dave is so distracting with his little, like.
No, I'm laughing that you're going to talk about Unicorn Western. I'm just waiting for all the commenters to leave now.
Oh. When we wrote Genesis, Johnny and I kind of came to the page with all we wanted to talk about oral tradition and storytelling and the nature of story, and that was kind of it. And through writing that, a lot of other themes, deeper themes, surfaced, and you kind of really have to listen to that. And I think that if you come to it from the other side, like, these are the big important issues that I'm trying to talk about, and these are the topics I want to cover, and this is what I want to say, I think you end up with something that's wordy, at best, pretentious, and just kind of tries too hard. Where when you let the novel, the characters, the story breathe and kind of say what they're trying to say, I think you end up with something much better and more natural.
All right, that was theme this week on Self-Publishing Podcast.
Well, I thought you'd have some stuff to say on this, Dave.
Your death thing. You always talk about death. Right?
Yeah. I am. Yeah, I am trying, or I was until this week, trying to write a story about a guy that loses his daughter in a car crash, and I want to write this profound thing on death, guilt, all these different things, the afterlife, just a whole bunch of different shit that's been in my head forever. And as I try to write this book, I want to say so much that I'm tongue-tied, and it's very difficult to get through. So difficult that, like, Sean wrote, Sean and I both decided we're going to write standalone novels. He has this one book that he started, and I had this one book that I started. We did a little story sessioning on both of them, so we're both involved in both stories. But, you know, one is a lead on one, and one's a lead on the other. So Sean wrote his entire fucking book. Meanwhile, my book is, like, sitting somewhere around the, you know, 40% mark. And it came time where it was my turn to edit Sean's book and work on that because, you know, he's done, and he's just waiting on me. This book's just sitting there waiting on Dave. So I couldn't make him wait any longer, so I actually put my book on hold while I go to his. And I'm hoping sometime while I'm, you know, working on his book that I'll, you know, return to mine and actually finish it. But for me, writing on themes is difficult. I think they creep into your work, you know, on a subconscious level or unconscious level, whatever, however you want to work
right,
that
but
out.
Right, but don't you think that the unconscious or the subconscious is more powerful than if you specifically set out to say, this is what I'm trying to say and what I'm trying to prove? Don't you think that's a little more heavy-handed than the stuff that just kind of bubbles up to the surface?
I guess it depends on the writer and how good they are, and obviously I'm not good enough yet to do that. So,
No, dude, I totally disagree with that. I think that your stuff very naturally, like you have like Children in Jeopardy, right? Like that's a good one.
A winning theme.
but it's what concerns you. It's death concerns you. Your family being in danger concerns you. So it's, I mean, yes, it's a,
I think the bigger theme is evil of. And I'm not even saying this as a joke sort of a thing on Dave, but I mean it's like the evil of humanity, like the dark side of life. It's not. I don't think you'd start out writing a book saying this is the dark side of life and let's talk about it. But there are people who do that, and it is heavy-handed, and it's like,
very heavy-handed, right? But in all of Dave's work,
usually literature in quotes, this is literature, and I'm not going to define it. It's literature. That's usually the sort of thing it is. Like,
yeah, and I think that. Truths can come from the things that you... You know what? Hold on.
I don't mean to imply that literature is all like that. What I meant was there are people who kind of... My book can't be defined. It's going to, you know...
I actually...
Cover thing.
I bought a book about a month or so ago, maybe a couple weeks ago, when I was struggling with this. I found a literature book, this guy that had written a story about death and stuff. I won't say what it was because I'm about to trash it, but it was like everybody like says how profound this book was and how every word was.
Wait,
like,
it was fiction or nonfiction?
It was fiction. Every word was like, you know, this magic recipe for, handed down from sages and elves and gods and stuff. Yeah, like the guy could do no wrong. He was walking on water writing this book, and it's supposed to be this great thing. And I started reading it because I want to see how he handled it, and I'm like, what the fuck! It's just like, no, that's not a story.
I don't know that I could sit down and write a book where it's like, I'm trying to say this and this and this. I know what happens to characters. I know what happens to their stories as, you know, as we go on. I know character arcs, and I know kind of what has to happen, but as far as what the large themes are, I think that would bog me down. I think I'd be so worried about whether or not I was effectively addressing those themes that I wouldn't be doing my job, which is to tell the story.
Go ahead, Dave.
Well, one of the things I was worried about was that my book was too concept-y, too heavy in those things. So I want to say so much in the book that I think it stifles a lot of what I'm trying to say. So I don't know. Anyway, go ahead.
What I was going to say is, I know you were joking about Sean was going to mention Unicorn Western, but the reason I think that really is a good example for this reason, because it's such an absurd concept that you couldn't start out with that. Like it would just be right. Stupid. Like let's if anybody has read the end of the saga of Unicorn Western, or especially anybody who has read all of Genesis, which is two people at this point, me and Sean, you would think like, okay, so it's about a gunslinger who rides a unicorn and shoots pink smoke, and we're gonna make it about the nature of, I don't know, what are the bigger
themes?
Oh
man, we started calling it a spiritual adventure. And the thing about Unicorn Western is it is a really, really big story, but Johnny's totally right. If we had started out to tell a really big story, it would have been a shit pile. Like, it just would have been. And because it would have been pretentious, it would have been full of itself, like, oh, you know, we're going to say important things with a unicorn. And I think that we do say important things in Unicorn Western. I'm really proud of the themes of that book. But they surfaced as we wrote it. It was not
intentional from the beginning.
Yeah, we did not sit down.
To give you an example, so you have something to put, and then you can elaborate on this, Sean. To give you something, so we're not just talking about the themes. Is one of the things that keeps coming up over and over again is that dark is as necessary as light. Yeah. So there's this tendency that we have, and in fantasy this happens a lot, but just in life in general, we say if something is good in air quotes, then it's good, and we should want more of it. And if something is dark or bad or evil, then we need to avoid that. And one of the things that came up, and again, I say it came up, it's not like we started out to say this, was the idea that they're both equal, that there is no good without bad, there is no bad without good. But that just came up. I mean, that's like it's organic.
It's contrast that's important. It's contrast that makes everything work. And so that was a pretty big theme. Actually, this is cool. So we didn't know what our themes were with Unicorn Western. Our theme was basically, let's make a funny book, like that kind of makes fun of Dave with the pink smoke. Like that was pretty much our goal for the
first
book.
Because I have another major body of work involving that.
All great literature.
So we did that, but by the time we got to Genesis, we already kind of knew what the big themes of Western were. So it was, how do we apply it to this new context? And one of the things that we did is kind of reboot Edward. So Edward is a total dick in Western. And in
we had somebody say that unicorns were ruined for her because our unicorn was so rude and dirty.
Yeah, he is. He's an asshole. He just is. But he's a lovable asshole, but he is an asshole. But in Genesis, he's not. He's a cult. And he's like, he Ooh. Loves the world. He's all excited and everything's
He's happening. Like you.
Yeah, no, he is. We
he is. And you turned him into me.
Yes, that's exactly right.
The arc.
Yes. And there's a moment in Genesis where you know exactly what turns him and why he becomes this other creature. And
by the way, let me just clarify really quickly that what is up right now is we're going to need to clarify this big time when we release the full Genesis. Because what's up there now is Genesis Origins. It's like a prelude. So if you've read that and you're wondering where this stuff Sean's talking about is, it's not in there. It's in the thing we still have to release.
Yeah, there's still like 70,000 words to go after that.
Spoiler alert.
But the whole thing is we knew what the major themes of Western were. So the way that, and this is actually in the part that you've read, if you've already read the Genesis that exists, this part is already covered. But how we basically started with the Adam and Eve story, the first unicorns ever were Adam and Eve. And it was a peach tree instead of an apple tree, but that it was necessary for Eve, the first female unicorn, to eat the peach because she had to introduce conflict into the world, and that without conflict, the world couldn't ever move forward. So yes, they had a paradise. Their version of Eden is called Mead. And yes, they had a paradise, but their paradise was worthless until there was conflict to move the world forward.
There you go. Dave, look at Dave over there. Look at him.
Dave is like, this is so stupid.
Carl wrote, Dave can comment on everything up to the wedding.
I don't get it.
Wait, what?
Don't you remember the show a couple weeks ago where I said I'd read it and I enjoyed it and you got to know how far I got?
Oh, that's right. That's right. And you're like, oh, I read up to the wedding. And we're like, that's page 3.
We have a lot of lovely comments. Ari says,
all right.
In response to what?
to me having difficulty with the writing and hating myself. And then she wrote, don't be an Eeyore. Carl said, we love Dave so much. A lot of Dave love here.
Wow, Dave's jerking off all over.
I have a third-party Dave comment if I could share this.
Third-party?
Totally
somebody emailed in?
No. It was from my dad.
What?
my dad is a Stern fan, and he really likes Howard Stern. So I sent, you know how like in if you listen to Howard Stern, there'll be something like they'll discover that Sal goes to the porno booths and beats off or something, and so it becomes this whole thing, right, on the show. And so when the decoy wallet thing happened on Better Off and Dead, I said, oh, there's one of those things. Like, this is our show just had one of those moments where we discovered this weird thing about Dave. So I sent him to the video. But I didn't have the audio. He's not going to sit there and listen to audio. I sent him the video. And Dave, what my dad said, my dad's an artist. And when I say he's an artist, I mean he paints. He does nothing remotely commercial. He paints paintings.
Okay.
And so he's always commenting on visual things. So he goes, that one guy, Dave, he goes, that's a really, and he's not gay either, my dad. He goes, that's a really handsome guy.
What?
About
handsome?
You. About you. He did say that. And he said
wait,
yes,
is
he
honestly.
Like, is Dave he like has one the prettiest eyes.
Is he like one of those Picasso painters? Or no, who's the guy that painted like flat people?
Oh, no, no, no. He writes very real. Here, if you're on YouTube, this is one of my dad's paintings right over there. That's from The Shining. He painted that.
Wow.
Wait, that's a painting? Not a photo?
Yeah, that's a painting. There's one of Eric Clapton over here if you're enjoying the... there, you see that. All right, so anyway. But yes, he did say that. So there you go. From an artist who does nothing but art, he said that you are a handsome guy.
So my mind is fucking blown right now.
Well, there you go. Everybody's always freaky. Saying how you have pretty eyes and
good. Is your dad going to ask to paint me nude or something?
I would pay a lot of money for that.
I don't know. I could ask.
Holding a fig leaf.
Yeah. Where were we going before we were talking about Daisy?
I just fucking lost it. I don't know. I don't think anybody's ever said that wasn't under some influence of drugs or something.
He's not under the influence of drugs. And
no, but he said I am.
Makes his living in visual stuff. So there you go. Yeah, exactly. He said, his comment about Sean was whoever came up with that chili gag in Unicorn Western was smoking weed.
Well, like, I think the more important question is, did he agree with a decoy wallet?
No, he thought you were crazy.
Okay, for the record.
I also enjoyed the moment in the last one where Dave looked to Sean's sister, who he's got a crush on or something, about, what? You know, did she think the decoy wallet was a good idea? And Sean goes, no, she thought you were crazy.
No, she thought you were fucking nuts. A decoy wallet. Just the idea is hilarious. So I'm sorry, Johnny, you were going to say something like a minute ago.
I was going to say something like 5 hours ago. The what I was thinking about with theme is that we just released Plugged yesterday. So Plugged is, if you didn't hear the last show or whatever, Plugged is, it's a meta piece about the world of the Beam. So it's written as nonfiction about the world of the Beam, but basically it's a vehicle for us to explain the world better to ourselves and to fans of the Beam. It answers a ton of questions about what is this in the Beam, where did this come from, it's the history.
Yeah, so we started, before we wrote season one, we started with a world-building doc that was kind of like a timeline for the 85 years in between then and now, the now of 2097 when it takes place, and it kind of just goes and explains everything that happened. And so when we did Plugged, we took that original world building doc and just kind of elaborated on it.
So what I was going to say with that is we started out to just, I mean, it had to have a theme to it. Like, we had to start with some message that we were trying to say. But it was surface level because it was meant to be sort of a Gladwell style book. And he has a point. So in Outliers, the point is that, you know, who you are is largely determined by where you stand within, you know, are you an outlier within your community, you know, and all this. So what we came up with was the tagline for the book, which is how hyperconnectivity and the Beam change the way we think. So the idea was, I didn't just want to tell this timeline. We had to tell the timeline with a purpose in mind, and the idea was that it changed the way that people are thinking. But what I found as I was writing the draft was that it went a lot deeper than that, and it started having some kind of, it kind of disturbed me in a little bit, because so much of what we were writing thematically for the Beam world was true in our world. And it was sort of like, oh, wow, I kind of don't, since the Beam is kind of a dystopian world, I mean, it's, the NAU's doing okay, but the rest of the world's kind of fucked, and I don't really want our current society to be very dystopian, and I was like, this is kind of really very similar. Do you have that comment that or the review that somebody emailed you?
I could find it. This was an early reader who got this, so they've already kind of made their way through it. Okay. Man, this is such a great story. The more I think about it, and I thought about it.
The early reader was Sean.
Man, this is such a great story. The more I think about it, and I've thought about it for days, the more powerful, the more real it becomes. You guys have hit on some real human truths in here, and anyone who writes will tell you that's not easy. As even the great Hemingway once said, great writing is true writing. He went on to say, in that same talk, that it's also hard as hell. I've read all of Gladwell's stuff. I love him dearly, too, despite my concern for his coziness with some in big industry, and love his style. I know that's what you were going for, but in my humble opinion, you guys exceeded it by making it your own. so very well done. I just can't describe how profound I think this book is, even though it's fiction. No matter, some of the most profound things I've ever read have been fiction. You guys did a fantastic, superlative job with this one. Loved it. And that's the thing. We didn't start out to say anything profound.
Signed, Charles Manson.
We started out to kind of explain. We had two
Malcolm
goals.
Malcolm Gladwell.
We had two goals with Plugged. We wanted to explain the world to ourselves because that's going to make season two that much better. The more that we, because the Beam is a really big world and there's a lot that happens, and the better that we understand that, the better job we're going to be able to do for our readers. And we also wanted to reward those readers who already love the Beam, and which is why, oh, by the way, this is a good time to mention this, because you may have read the Beam and you're not on the Realm and Sands list, and we're not charging for, we figure our, the Beam's biggest fans have left reviews of the Beam. So if you've left a review for season one, just send me an email and I'll send you Plugged for free. Because that's, you know, primarily the other reason we wrote it is to, you know, the true Beam fans are going to want to more know more about that world, because it's all the stuff that isn't said in the Beam is almost as exciting as the stuff that is said. And so we wanted to touch on some of that. Anyway, send me an email if you've left.
I do have to say I'm rather surprised. I was in the Kobo dashboard and saw that the Beam is selling very fucking well. So congratulations.
Thank you. And I would, I think that that is because of its price tag.
Yeah,
which is
yeah,
a separate issue.
We've talked this to death, so.
Yeah, but we haven't
to the. We talk it to death in the book too.
yeah, well, Unicorn Western Full Saga is also selling quite well on Kobo, which is interesting too. So, what I want, Sean, how do we get? Hey, I'm sure Mark is listening. Do you remember when they featured it in that thing that was supposed to, that the other people, that the two things on either side of Unicorn Western were getting, quote, hundreds of sales per hour or something?
Yeah, and
how
we got
do
three.
That? Yeah, how do we do that with the Beam? Like, how do we do that?
I don't know. We'll send Mark an email.
We've got some breaking important comments. Oh, go ahead.
I just want to mention really, really, really quick before, because if we mentioned Kobo, this is like the most hodgepodge show ever. They are picking the people who won the Kobo reader, and actually they're going to give two away, two listeners.
Wow,
so
awesome.
We don't have answers on that yet as to who those people are, but we're going to get to announce them, and then they will contact you directly. So they picked two. Like, you can't enter anymore, so don't, you can't go back and lick balls on this.
Damn it!
Basically they picked one person. They said they'd give away one, and they gave away one just random drawing, and then they gave away one to the subset of people who said that they'd already signed up for Writing Life to publish on Kobo, because they're like, hey, might as well reward those people. So they're giving away two. So we'll have, maybe next week we'll know about that.
That's cool.
So Dave, you were doing comments.
Our breaking comments. Jacob Tulos writes, Johnny's dad is like that guy in American Beauty that finds beauty in everything. That guy on American Beauty that finds beauty. I'm like that floating bag.
You're a plastic bag, basically.
Mary said, so Johnny's dad agrees with all us females. Wow, thank you, Mary. and then a whole bunch of people are saying that was some amazing artwork. And then Pam Stuckey writes, it's Dave's face. I read faces. He has a kind, happy face. Yeah,
happy.
I don't think anybody thinks.
I'll give you
out
kind.
Of the three of us, I love that Dave's getting the happy face.
My wife thinks that, okay, like when we go out, she thinks I have murder face. Like, she's like, you're looking at that person like you want to murder them. it's just my normal face.
The fun part about this is that since this discussion has come up, I'm looking very closely at Dave. Like, I find myself looking like, so I'm like, is he, I'm like, is he a pretty man? Like, I'm trying to figure it out, you know?
He's a pretty man.
Wow.
I worked in a flower shop for getting him. He's a pretty man.
Can you give him a dust jacket blurb flower. For that? If he ever finishes that book, can you give him a blurb for the cover? He's
yes,
a pretty man.
A very pretty man. Pretty
man. Ari said it's my sparkling eyes. See, I used to get compliments on my eyes a lot, but I don't take that as a compliment. I take that as, like, everything else about you is so fucking hideous, but your eyes are not bad.
Yeah, Dave doesn't know how to take a compliment at all. So anyway, are we done talking about theme?
Yeah, we might be. It's like the most circular whatever.
I don't know.
Well, I thought of this because Stephen King talks about this in On Writing, and he says that the good writing starts with characters and story and progresses to theme, and that usually starting the other way around is kind of makes you bloated and, you know.
Yeah,
kind of
I totally agree with that. I think if you want to get really great at saying stuff without purposefully trying to say it, just start paying attention, you know, in the not just the books that you read, but the TV that you watch, the movies that you watch. Well-written stuff always has great theme, but it's not necessarily, you know, how they sell the show, because they're not selling you Breaking Bad on the theme of the show. The theme is just, it's there, and you can watch it, and you get to watch their arcs and all of that, but they're not selling the theme. So there's always two layers.
Tough thing to sell.
there's always the show or the movie that you're watching, and then there's the thing under it that the creators are trying to say, and that's not always on purpose. And as Dave said earlier, a lot of that is subconscious. And personally, I think the more subconscious it is, probably the better it is.
That's a good point. I think that a lot of times the writer or the filmmaker or whoever it is isn't necessarily aware of the themes that may be in the work. I actually I had some thoughts. One of my friends had some thoughts on Gravity, but I don't. It would spoil stuff, so I'm not going to say it. But I thought that was interesting. So Sean, you and I can talk about it later.
Oh, I'd love to. I actually want to see that again. I thought that movie was extraordinary. But that's a good example, because we don't have to talk about what the themes are. But there are some definite themes in that movie that aren't like, they're not hitting you over the head with it at all. It's a very quiet, very taut, well-paced movie. But that's a good example of a film where there's two movies. There's the one that you get to see and the one that you get to think about. And when you read a book, it's the same thing. When you write a book, it's the same thing. There's the story that you're telling, and then there's what that story says. And when you're describing, here's a good way to kind of think about it. If you're telling a friend about a book or a movie or a TV show or whatever, you're not telling them about the theme of that show. You're telling them about what happens, or you're telling them about characters or exchanges or something like that. But the reasons that you like that show, the reason that it resonates with you, the reason that you even want to tell your friend about it is because of the theme. Even though there may be really cool exchanges, there may be a great line of dialogue that you can't wait to repeat, but the theme is what anchors it to your soul. It's what makes you want to care about it, because it's somehow speaking to you in a way that you may not even realize that it's speaking to you. And that's the job of theme, is to make your work resonate beyond what's just on the page, what's there in between the words. And it's really important as a creator that you do that, that you're not just telling stories. So for example, Dave shits on us all the time about our comedies, even though he's not
read.
He
loves it when you bring it up, even to exemplify something.
Yeah, well, it's amazing, because he hasn't
almost
even,
two, right?
he hasn't read a single one, but he totally shits on all of them, which I think is hilarious. But even within our comedies, we're always saying something. I think it's impossible for Johnny and I to get together on a project and not say something. Greens is probably our stupidest comedy, and still we're saying stuff about marketing and about the people's belief systems and about, you know, being spoon-fed information.
Okay, if you're going to bring this up, you're going to make me argue with you, and we really don't want to get into that. But my problem isn't the stories, it's the fucking titles of them, okay? Let's just leave it at that and drop it, otherwise this show's going to go on another fucking hour, all right? All right.
I love it when it goes on another hour. And I love fighting with you, Dave. We have great makeup sets.
For the record, I don't think that Space Shuttle has any theme whatsoever.
Okay, I agree with that.
We got a breaking comment. Mary said, my husband also commented that with a decoy wallet in your other pocket, it won't be so painful sitting in the car. And he also thought it was a good idea. So,
yeah, I think if we ever do any sort of a public appearance with all three of us, there's going to be all sorts of chicks coming up and getting on Dave.
Show us your wallet! Show us your wallet! Flip it out!
Is that a decoy wallet in your pocket, or are you just happy to see me, big boy?
Well, I do carry my wallet in my front pocket, so anything's possible.
I don't carry a wallet. Where's the line for that?
You don't carry a wallet?
No, I hate wallets. I'm the opposite of George Costanza with his big giant wallet.
I have a very thin wallet, but I carry a wallet.
All right. We got another show coming up.
Yeah, we got another show coming up. We do have a guest. And
2:00 to 2:15. She's okay. Watching in the comments.
We'll bring you in from the get go. So we need a few minutes to reset. But so we'll just go ahead and finish. Where's my music? There we go. So I don't even know what we have to announce. You guys have anything new?
Dave something will.
Dave's 40% into something. Enjoy it.
Thank you again if you've left a review for Writer Dad. They're very touching.
And I guess. And Plugged is out if you enjoy Plugged.
Yeah, and if you've left a review for The Beam, send me an email.
Send it to Sean, not me. I don't want to be answering emails.
Right. All right, this has been the Self-Publishing Podcast. We'll see you next time, everybody.
Of course, it'll probably help if Sean gave his email address out.